But yeah, he said he was confused. Okay. So he's not around low guys in the mathematics class with us. Okay. So let's continue. So just to remind you, last time we worked out the mathematics of Kalman-Sack line induction. And so we're moving to a study of strings on compact spaces. So as a warm-up, we worked out the study of field gradient, which is ordinary gravity, Einstein gravity on a Kalman-Sack line space. And we discussed how the action, Einstein's limit on action, reduced on a circle. You got a redefined dilaton, a redefined Einstein field. You got an extra scalar corresponding to the size of the circle, and you got a gauge field corresponding to G mu 9. Okay? And we worked out the action for that. That's it. We also discussed how objects carry charge, carry momentum in the extra direction of charge and this gauge field. And we discussed how the B mu nu field decomposes into a gauge field and a lower dimension of the union field. There's an exercise that I asked you guys to do, which all of you have done. Okay, now we're going to move to the study of string theory. And we discussed also that the gauge field that came from the dimensional reduction of the B mu nu field, namely B mu 9, were different in field theory from the gauge field that came from the graviton, in the sense that there were obvious modes that were charged under the gauge field that came from the graviton, anything that carried momentum in the extra direction. But if there was no, in field theory, there were no modes that were charged under the gauge field that came from mu 9, and we promised that this would change when we looked at string theory. Okay, so now we're going to start studying string theory with an extra compact circle. First one, and then we eventually look at main compact circles. Okay. So let's say that we have an x25, but we'll soon drop this subscript just because it's too cumbersome. So whenever I write an x, we need to drop it. I mean x25, and we have x is equal to x plus 25. Okay. Now this object is a field, whereas 2 pi r is a number. Okay? So what does this identification mean? It means that the field x is identified with the field x plus 2 pi r. So doing a mode expansion, this identification affects only the zero mode of x. Okay? So this immediately tells us that all analysis of conformal invariants and so on is local on the world sheet. You know, local on the world sheet, local in space time. Okay? So nothing is going to be affected. All the local properties of the OPs and so on are not going to be affected by yeah? Okay? However, so this continues to be a conformal field theory. So some identification of an old conformal field theory. So it's going to be a good background for a string property. Okay? All that's going to be affected is the zero. So we're not going to work out everything that we got from the oscillators again, we're just going to focus on the zeros. So let's do that. So how does the zero mode work? So what is the action? The action is 1 over 4 pi alpha prime del alpha x is x. Now, if we substitute in just zero mode here, we got something very simple. We got the integral over 2 pi moved away, and we got 2 alpha prime. Integral x dot okay, let's get the point. Okay, so what did it do is to substitute in the zero. Now let's work this out from two different points of view. The first point of view is that worked out from two different points of view eventually. But what let's think of this object. You know, what's different in the zero volt sector? The thing that's different in the zero volt sector is that a string, okay, with this x being compactified, as you go around the sigma circle. So what we're trying to do is to first work out our spectrum analysis. Imagine we're doing a lot like light cone quantization once again, like first few lectures of our course. We're working on the cylinder of the world shape, and we're trying to work on the spectrum. Okay, so what's different? The thing that's different in the xenomorph sector here is that as we go around the sigma circle, it's not necessary for x to come to be periodic. You know, so what we've done is taken x previously and expanded it as x 0 is a function of time plus sum over I n, sum over n by I n sigma times sum alpha n. And then proceeded to one test. Okay? This cycle expansion, you know, works with this periodicity, but it's too restrictive. It's not necessary for x to come back to itself as you go around the sigma circle, which is the boundary condition we propose in this expansion. All that's necessary is that x come back to itself up to a multiple of 2 pi r. Okay? So the most general expansion will be this plus 2 plus m sigma r. X of sigma and tau will be equal to m sigma r. Okay? For something. Okay? So let's call this x. M sigma tau will be m sigma r plus x0 is a function of time plus tau. Is this clear? This m sigma r is dated because sigma goes from sigma to 2 pi. This quantity changes from x, wherever it was, to 2 pi r times n, which is the allowed periodicity. Okay? So the field space that we're working with splits up into different sectors, labeled by a winding number n. This winding number tells us how many times the Tauric space field wraps as it goes around the world sheet center.
This is only for the closed strings?
Yeah. Yes, only for closed strings. It's very different for closed strings. We'll return to closed strings. So sorry, I should set up by leaving the closed strings. Yeah, this is the analog of this will be deeper in closed strings. We'll return to that. Okay. So we've got this kind of expansion into sectors. You know, yeah, field splits into some of the sectors, and each sector we do such an expansion. Okay, so the quantization of this part is unaffected, and is independent of which sector. So in each sector we have a bunch of harmonic oscillators whose frequency is goes from 1 to infinity, both to the left movers and to the right. Okay? So all we need to... So let's forget about this one. And why just about this part? Okay. So when we do the quantization of this system, what changes? So once again, fine. So there are two things that change. The first thing is that when we plug this kind of configuration into this action, we get a contribution in the action. And more importantly, a contribution in L0 and L0 bar from the two space derivatives sitting this way. Okay? We'll see that more clearly as we go. The second thing that's more important for our current purposes is that the quantization of this X0 thing, which is just a quantization of 1 over 2 alpha prime, X0 dot squared, quantization of this action, looks like it's not changed. But that's not true. Because all wave functions have to be periodic until x0 goes to x0 plus 2 pi r. Okay? So, the quantization of this is a free particle moving on a circle, which effectively just quantizes the momentum in the x25 direction. So, the momentum in the x25 direction, p25, is restricted to be equal to n by r. Okay? the solution of you know, of this X field in the Mth sector. So the Mth sector, Xm of tau sigma, we've got this new piece at the bottom there, which is M sigma, and then we have the old piece, which was, if you remember, alpha prime times P times tau. Okay? Why is the alpha prime here, somebody? What fixes the fact that this, that if we want momentum, this thing we identify with momentum, we need to put an alpha prime?
The correct,
you have the correct combination. Exactly. So the canonical momentum corresponding to x0 is 1 over alpha prime times x0 naught. Yeah, then you can't eventually argue that it's alpha prime or alpha prime. Okay. The canonical momentum is x0 dot divided by alpha prime. Apply x0 dot here, we get alpha prime dot p. Divide by alpha prime, you get prime p. Okay? Fine. But we know that this p is n by r. So, in the expansion of the field, we get m sigma r plus n by r alpha prime times tau. And plus the oscillators, which are unchanged, but what we have. Okay, now let's rewrite this whole thing. It would be useful to rewrite this whole thing. It would be useful to rewrite this whole thing in terms of sigma plus of sigma. So let's remind ourselves that sigma plus is equal to tau plus sigma. Sigma minus is equal to tau minus sigma. So tau is equal to sigma plus sigma minus by 2. Sigma is equal to sigma plus minus sigma minus by 2. So let's plug that in, yeah? So we get sigma plus into, so we get this x is equal to sigma plus into, well, from here we get n by r alpha prime. We have n by r alpha prime, the whole by 2, n by r alpha prime. So that's, maybe it's a good idea to put an alpha prime by 2. Okay, so n by r plus m r alpha prime plus alpha prime by 2 into sigma minus into n by r minus m.
Term containing M
has to what? Oh, you're right. Sorry. Thank you. Okay. Now, this quantity here, this quantity that appears behind sigma plus, with an alpha prime by 2 taken out, okay, we give it a name. We call it PL. Oh. And we define PR is equal to N by R minus MR. Okay. Had there been no winding at M with 0, then PL and PR would both have been equal to the momentum. Just N by R. Okay? The bare quantities that play the role of momentum multiplied by the left moving coordinate in the string. Okay? And or the right moving coordinate in the string. So you see, when x had been a periodic field, then the whole expansion of x in the left, you know, the separation of x into left movers and right movers, both for oscillators, but not for the zero. The zero mode, if we try to make such an expansion, as we did at some point, of course, the coefficient of this would have been p, and the coefficient of that would have been p. So for the zero modes, left movers and right movers were linked, in the sense that their coefficients were forced to be the same. Now we're seeing some sort of relaxation of this link. The left moving momentum, that is the left moving contribution to the zero mode, and the right moving contribution to the zero mode need not be the same. And in fact, in the mth sector, are not the same.
The left moving contribution to the momentum is real difference.
Left moving contribution to the momentum
will be
half of this.
The total momentum is PL plus PR.
The total momentum is n by r. Pn reduces to n by r if n is equal to 0. So taking all the halves out, such that Pn would have been the ordinary momentum had winding been 0. Similarly, Pr would have, we accounted for the normalization of the manifestly, that's why it took this alpha prime to point, to get an object that would have reduced the momentum otherwise.
So if you want to think of it physically as the momentum carried by the left moving,
you see, it's not quite, well, as the momentum carried by the left moving.
For example, you know, if I write on the march formula.
Right.
Then get it.
We'll do that just now. It's a PL, you see, in the mass formula, PL will appear exactly like P appeared before. Because much reduced to the role mass formula will appear. Okay? So fine. So at the formal level, what we're doing here physically is clear. We're adding white. But you see something interesting is happening at the formal level. At the formal level, it's making zero modes behave more like the oscillators. In the sense that we're allowing what's happening on the zero mode side of the left movers and the zero mode side of the right movers to become different. We're allowing ourselves to become different, for these two things to be different, the left and right. Is this clear? Okay, now let's immediately write down what Lohmann was asking about. And read the dispersion relation, the formula for the mass sequential particles that arise in this compact relation. Okay? So now to that we want to know what L0 is. So L0, as before, gets contribution only from PL, and with the normalizations that would have said, you know, equal to P. PL is equal to P. L0 is equal to alpha prime by 4, it's the usual one, PL squared plus alpha prime by 4 P squared. Okay, so this is, now this, the rest is in the non compact direction, this is what we call the mass squared. It's minus alpha prime by 4 mass squared. Minus because space like momentum copy is negative mass. Right? And then plus nL minus 1. nL is the naive oscillator number, and the minus 1 comes with the energy of the drug set, catching the energy of the drug set. Okay? And L0 bar is equal to minus alpha prime by 4 BR squared minus alpha prime by 4 m squared plus nR. You understand? Look, suppose we've got a mode, okay? It carries some momentum in the non-compact directions.
Only this mode.
This mass square is k square minus mass square is k square in the non-compact dimensions.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Right? Which we equate to mass square because we have Schrodinger type equation with this value of the mass.
So are we thinking of it as an extra compact dimension or okay, this is the mass if we are dimensionally reduced.
This is the mass if we are dimensionally reduced. You see, mass is a well-defined notion when we've got a Poincaré algebra. And we've got no Poincaré algebra in the direction in which we dimensionally reduced.
Okay.
So we're looking at the mass square of the effective particle in 25 dimensions. Okay? So by mass square I just mean k is minus of k square in the non-compact. Is this clear? Okay? So, we get the formula mass square is equal to PL square plus 4 pi alpha prime into n L minus 1 and also equal to PR square plus 4 pi alpha prime into n R. Now, when we were dealing with the x coordinates that had no identification, PL is equal to PR, and the equality of these two told us that NL is equal to NR. Now PL is not necessarily equal to PR, and NL needn't be equal to NR. What we want to do is that these two quantities are the same. Okay? But it needn't, that needn't in general will not imply that NL and NR are the same. Okay, so,
so there is some complicated relationship between M and N here because NL minus NR would be an integer, right? If we just subtract.
Yes. So we will not be able to satisfy the Marshall condition for arbitrarily m n. You know, so for crazy values of the radius, okay, we will not have physical particles So Loganathan's point is that if we subtract these two, so let's do that. So Loganathan's point is that if we subtract these two, what will we get? Okay, so what we get here is PL squared minus PR squared, which is equal to 4 times MN by alpha. Okay, and that must be equated with NR minus NL 4 by alpha. Okay, so the equivalent of the level matching condition for alpha cancel is that NR minus NL is M times N. So you fix the value of N, you fix the value of N, then you must satisfy this condition. You must choose your oscillator excitations. That's the way to think of it. Fix some n, then you have to choose your oscillator excitation from the right and the left, such that this difference is there.
We still have transition invariance in this.
We have translation.
Is this the statement of that? Is that
correct? I didn't understand.
What do you mean? I mean, so we should get some condition out of that. Imposing
some condition out of
it. Is that, I mean, condition on.
This charge here, this. You know, N by R is the momentum corresponding to translation invariance. I have understood. You know, this is just a level matching condition on the string. The fact that L0 has to be equal to L0 bar. Okay? Applied to this system. And it reduces, in the case that N is equal to 0, to the condition that NR is equal to N. But it's different from the condition at R is equal to NL and norm 0 NL. But notice that you're looking at an integer. So it's a fulfillable condition. It's not something that depends on R or depends on alpha prime. Given any M and N, there are always values of NR and NL that satisfy this condition. Is this clear? Okay, good. Let's go. Now, I want to look at this Mach squared formula in a little more detail. Okay? So, let me look at this... Before going into the detailed analysis that I'm going to go into in a moment, notice one thing in which this PL, both PL squared and PR squared have a certain invariance property, a certain formal invariance property. So suppose I do the following. Suppose I take R and set it to alpha prime divided by R. Okay? And I said M is equal to N prime and N is equal to M prime. Then PN as a function of R, M, and N is equal to PL as a function of R prime, M prime, and N prime. Whereas PR as a function of R, M, and N is equal to minus PR as a function of R prime, M prime. Can you see this? You see, I exchange R by alpha prime by R. So I get alpha prime times R prime, yeah? And I exchange N by N. So this term becomes that term, and vice versa. Similarly, these two terms get flipped. And because the left minus I become, they become this minus. Okay, so what does this say? This already tells us something very interesting. Okay, it tells us that a string on a circle of radius r has exactly the same spectrum as a string on the circle of radius alpha prime. The spectrum is the same thing. But in order to map states to each other, you need to flip labels. This flipping of labels is M is equal to N prime and N is equal to N. Now this is from the point of view of quantum field theory. I mean, the point of view of just gravity of a circle seems very non-intuitive. You see, because if you just have gravity in a circle, you've got a bunch of massive modes coming from the Knudsen time state. And these states are more and more massive if the circle gets smaller and smaller. Certainly, it's not true that a small circle and a big circle have the same spectrum. So what's going on? You see, what's going on is that in string theory, in addition to the Kalousa-Klein states, you have states that wrap the string, the winding states. Now, just as the Kalousa-Klein modes get heavier and heavier as the circle goes smaller and smaller, the winding states go lighter and lighter as the circle goes smaller and smaller. So, the heavy Kalousa-Klein states of a small circle turn out to have exactly the same mass as the heavy winding states of a big circle if we change R to alpha prime. And vice versa. Okay? So you see something very interesting. If you're looking at physics from the point of view of a low energy observer, you cannot, at least at the level of spectrum, you shouldn't see that this is a more general thing than just a spectrum. You cannot distinguish between string theory compactified in a circle of size R and string theory compactified in a circle of size alpha prime prime. The spectrums are identical. And the way it works is that the winding states in one picture, that's the momentum states in the other picture. And vice versa. What winding and momentum quantum numbers are interchanged. Okay? We've only seen the subpart level spectrum. We'll soon, either the end of this lecture or the next lecture, understand this is a full non-perturbative symmetry of string theory. Okay? This is our first glimpse of the symmetry of string theory called T-duality. Okay? Now, just a little word, we're going to go on with our technical analysis in a moment, but just a little word about T-duality. T-duality hints at something. It's just a hint because it's just, well, it's just a hint. But it hints at a phenomenon that we will see again and again in string theory. That in string theory, it's hard to go beyond the minimum length scale, in some sense of thinking. You see, you might have thought that you were sort of looking at a compactification that dealt with very small length scales, like compactifying a very small circle. But it turns out you get exactly the same spectrum as if you compactified a large circle. Okay? So, in string, you know, more, in a more fundamental way, we would say that there is no way to distinguish a string compactification on a very small circle from a very large circle. There's no way to distinguish string compactification on a circle of size R from string compactification on a circle of size alpha prime. So the very notion of, you know, whether something is big or small, once you get down to string length, at least as far as the size of the circle is concerned, seems to become ambiguous. Okay? And this is one of the first indications, and we'll see many of these as we go along, that somehow the notion of space and time must get modified in string theory. The absoluteness of big and small must get modified in string theory. How that plays out in the end has not yet been worked out properly. We don't understand exactly what replaces these. But we have any hints that this notion must get replaced. Yes?
Is this true even if we slightly deform the circle?
Is this true if we slightly deform it or what meaning?
Let's say
it's normal circle. You see, you can have to do it in a way that solves the equation of motion. Okay? So now in many situations there are generalizations of this to so let's look at string theory compactified in a Calabi-Yau manner. Some complicated compactification. There are analogous phenomena to this. Okay, these phenomena called mirrors. Okay, we discuss much of these things as well. Okay.
Is there a reason why you would expect that this would be true about arbitrary?
No, I don't. You know, I don't. One shouldn't take this too far. It's not a claim that, you know, basically the point is, you know, basically at the level that we're talking about, the main point is that, you know, there are winding modes and there are momentum modes, and you can interchange the two. Okay, as long as this statement continues to be true, at some intuitive level, you'll have a hard time distinguishing between big circle with winding and small circle with momentum.
Okay, can I just rephrase this?
Please.
Let's say even like I take some bunch of strings.
Yes.
So you know you definitely have some gravitational effect, right? Because there's a gravity in the field.
Yes.
And this circle will react to that.
This circle will react to that, yes.
Because it's part of this question.
Yes.
Now, so in what sense are we saying that we can't distinguish between the two? In the sense that, I mean, if you give me a small circle, and if you give me a big circle, can I, with slightly deforming the circles, make out whether it's a big circle?
What do you mean by slightly deforming? I mean,
by using string probes, in a sense.
You see, anything that can be built as a small detonation out of this cannot be distinguished, because any experiment you perform in one picture has the count. Yes, okay, what is true is that, you know, suppose you've got a massive state. Okay? If you can prepare a probe that you know is winding up, then you can check whether that state is winding or moving. So, if you have some way of saying this is winding and that is momentum, then you can distinguish between these two pictures. Okay? But for any experiment you can perform in one picture, there is a corresponding experiment you can able to perform in the other picture. With different probes, but which will get the same result.
I mean, there is obviously my probes don't deform the circle, but I mean, is it evident even if the probes...
You see, conformal field theories here are just the same. Okay, so to the extent that string perturbation theory is determined completely by the worldsheet conformal field theory, these two things are the same string compact definition. You see, any question you have to one picture has a corresponding, any experiment you set up in one picture has a corresponding experiment you set up in the other picture, it will give you the same answer. You see, both momentum states and winding states live all over the circle. Both of them carry gravitation. Now, it's not obvious that you can distinguish in some invariant way, and it's to the extent that string perturbation theory comes at least. It's not true. There's nothing you can do as a small perturbation around this picture to distinguish between these. These two are, we haven't shown that, but I will show you. That these are just identical as conformal field theories. And string perturbation theory is determined by the conformal field theory of the worldsheet strings. Two things are identical. Conformal field theory is just identical. It gives you identical perturbation.
I'm just worried that this statement that they're identical seems to depend on the fact that this thing is a circle. I mean, both of them are circles.
So, but if you can take something and think of it as a small deformation around this,
okay.
It's a small deformation in one picture or the other.
Okay. So, any small deformation here, you're saying, can be mapped out. So
can be written in either picture.
Because any small deformation is just some amount of.
Some vertex operator put on this thing, and this. If it's one, you put this vertex operator in one picture, it's another. It's the mapped vertex operator.
So if I start here and start deforming, okay,
right,
using vertex operators,
right,
then at least to the extent that the string perturbation theory is valid.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, this, I mean,
you will not be able to distinguish this from starting with the other picture, putting on the corresponding deformation, and doing the corresponding. Okay. We're going to get back either at the end of this lecture or later in the next lecture to a deep more detailed study of T-duality. It will be useful to have the vertex operators corresponding to these states. And this one was just to whet your appetite. So let's now go back to the analysis of the spectrum. Okay? And let me start by analyzing the spectrum. First, you know, as in our study of non-compact string theory, a particularly interesting question is, what are the master states over there? Let's first do this with an arbitrary value of the radius. And then specialize the special radii. Okay? A radius that will turn out to be particularly interesting is the radius at which this, under this operation, r does not change. Namely, r is equal to square root of r. Okay? That will help us in our understanding. But let's first just do this at arbitrary radius. Okay, so suppose we want to understand what the massless particles in the theory are. Okay, we want to understand what the massless particles in the theory are at some arbitrary radius. Now, because r enters in a complicated fashion in this expression, if we're in an arbitrary radius, the only way to, you know, generically, the only way to satisfy this relationship is to have this equal to 0. back the order last. So we have n l equals 1, n r equals 1. And after. Okay? And so what are the modes? What are the states? The states are alpha minus 1, alpha tilde minus 1, m n, acting on 0. But remember, these m n's could be either 25 or mu. So now there are many options from the point of view of the lower dimension theorem. Firstly, if m n equals mu, what we recover is the dilaton, the graviton, the BBU nu field of the lower dimension. If n, m and n are both run from 1 to 25. However, if one of m and n is mu and the other one is 25, okay, what do we then recover? So then, let's, for instance, suppose we have alpha minus 1, 25, alpha tilde minus 1, mu. This has a single space-time index, so it's a gauge field. Okay, so we recover a Master's gauge field. There's a second Master's gauge field, which is minus 1, mu, alpha tilde, 25. Actually, it's a symmetric and anti-symmetric combinations of these that are most natural. Okay? And these two Master's gauge fields are what we saw in our analysis of the time compactification last class. Namely, the Master's gauge fields that came from having one leg of the graviton in the 25 direction and one leg of the BBU in the 25 direction. Okay? And finally, there's a case where we have alpha minus 125, alpha tilde minus 125. Okay. You know? And this is a scalar of what appears to the remaining non-compact dimensions, and it's the additional scalar that corresponded to the size of the circle. Remember, we had, in addition to the lower dimension dilaton, an extra scalar, which is the size of the circle.
How do you identify which one among the gauge fields?
Among the gauge fields, you see, from the point of view of field theory, one of the gauge fields came from dimensional reduction of the graviton.
Right.
The graviton is a symmetric one. But the other one came from the dimensional reduction of BMU, and BMU is pansexual. Okay? Good. So, add arbitrary values of the radius, we've recovered what we saw last time from field. Okay. There's just one little point I want to make. Here. Which goes as follows. Let's look at the vertex operator corresponding to the gauge field that came from BBU. Okay? So alpha minus 1 maps to delta x. Alpha tilde minus 1 maps to delta x. So the vertex operator will be of the form del x25 del bar x mu times minus del x mu del bar x times e to the power I k dot x, where this k is purely in the non-compact dimensions. Okay? So this is going to be the vertex operator that corresponds to the gauge field that came from the dimensional reduction of BBU. Now, if you're interested in measuring the charge, okay, the net charge of the system, you couple, the derivative of a Lagrangian with respect to A mu gives you the gauge field. Okay, A mu at x gives you, the current at x. And if you're interested in J mu integrated over all space, you take the derivative with respect to the zero power of A in momentum space. So we're interested in measuring net charge under the gauge field that comes from the coupling BBU. We should be interested in this vertex operator at k equals 0. Okay. Now, at k equals 0, that's what this vertex operator is. And it's very near to be trivial. It's very near to be trivial, as you can see in the following way. You see, this thing we can write as, using the equation of motion of, exactly, let's take a delta, x25, delta bar, okay, this, I've subtracted an extra term here, which is delta bar of x2, which is 0, okay, and then we could also write this term here as minus, for instance, delta bar of x25, we could do it many ways. Right. But what I want you to notice is that each of these terms here is a total derivative. Okay? So this object, if we were working on a compact word sheet, and if this quantity was single valued, okay, then insertion of such a quantity onto the word sheet would give you something trivial. It would just give you something that's zero by the equations of motion. For instance, if this was the integrated vertex operator and calculating some correlation function. Okay? So, if the other operators that we insert into the worksheet, onto the worksheet, don't create are such that this vertex operator, the path integral in the presence of those vertex operators, all these single valued fields, then we just get zero. On the other hand, x25 need not be single valued. The other vertex operators that you put into your worksheet could force x25 to wind around. And then this vertex operator is not true. Okay? So what we're seeing is the fact that only states that have winding number in x25 can carry charge under the gauge field that comes from unit. Now, in fact, the states that have winding number under x25 do carry charge under the gauge field that comes from linear. And to convince yourself of that, I'd like to suggest a little calculation. Okay? I want you to calculate the three-point function, three-point scattering, of the gauge field now with some of the units. Of the gauge field that comes from beam union with some momentum, and two tachyon operators which have equal amounts of momentum. Okay? Now,
can we just agree from this?
Yeah. You could. Basically, what you're going to get is,
Because the charge and the gravity, I mean, the mu from gravity is basically n.
Right.
So, I mean, if the interchange have to work out, then the charge and the mu should be n.
That's absolutely right. And, yeah. As we will see, this T-duality symmetry is a symmetry under which xl goes to, is equal to xl, whereas xr goes to minus xr.
In 25.
And under the symmetry, momentum gets interchanged with winding, the gauge field from beam union gets interchanged with gauge field from graviton. So that follows from all of that. But nonetheless, I would like you guys just to do this calculation explicitly. Okay? So what calculation there is to do is clear, right? You know what the vertex operators are, you know? I haven't quite told you about the vertex operators for states that carry winding. This is gone slightly more than I'm going to tell you about that in a moment. Once I told you about that, you know what vertex operators to insert. Okay? And you know what the vertex operator for this B field, for this B gauge field is that we've written out. Yeah? There is a simple generalization of the many calculations we did before for three-point functions in the closure sector. Okay, but I'd like you to do the calculation just to get your hands wet on this stuff. And to check that you will find it coupling only with states that have non-zero winding. Okay. As Lord Brabham says, there are many more structural and sort of general ways of understanding this. Okay, good. So, while I bring this up at the moment, I brought it up because already at the left at an arbitrary radius, we see one phenomenon in string theory that we did not see in field theory. Namely, the gauge field that comes from this BB of mu carries states that have charge. And these states are states that are not the extra circle. Okay. So, as arbitrary value of the radius, if we are interested only in this massless state, no? That's it. No, there's nothing else.
But all these states are things, right?
Which are the states?
I mean, the states that charge in the...
And arbitrary values of radius are strong. Okay? Not at every value of the radius are strong.
Yeah.
Okay? However, now you just to answer the kind of question you're trying to ask. Okay? Let's focus on the particularly interesting value of the radius. The particularly interesting value of the radius that we focus on is r is equal to square root alpha. This is the self-dual point on the r goes to alpha prime alpha. Okay? It's the point in which there are two different descriptions of the same theory. Of the same theory without changing radius. Okay? And let's example the spectrum here as a warm up to understanding the physics of it. So I'm interested in the mass of the spectrum. So we have that n squared was equal to n by r plus w r by alpha prime. Yeah, the whole thing squared plus n l minus 1. It was also equal to n by r plus w minus w r by alpha prime plus n r. This is to integral. Now if we said r equals square root alpha prime, what happens? What happens is that was a 4 by alpha. Each of these things has is proportional to 1 over square root. So we get m squared is equal to 4 by alpha prime into n plus w, the whole thing squared by 4 plus n l minus 1 is equal to 4 by alpha prime into n minus w, the whole thing squared by 4 plus n r minus. As the special value of the radius. Okay? And now let's search for solutions to the problem of masses. Okay, so let's start. See, we have to cancel this minus 1. We can do it either with nl or with this n plus w. So let's see how we can do it with n plus w. Okay, so I'm going to write n w in a bracket like this to denote the quantum numbers of the set. So one way we can do it is if we choose n w to be 2, 0. You see, in order to cancel minus 1, this 1, minus 1, we need n plus w to be equal to 2. So one way to do this is to choose n w to be 2, 0. That way, and that way nl and nr both equal 0 will satisfy this equation. And give you a master's part. You see? Because this will give you 2 squared, so that's 1 minus 1 plus 0. we've done this, there are clearly three other solutions to this function. Like minus 2 0. Let's put this in the bracket. 0 2 and 0 2. Each of them with ml into nr 2. Okay? And that's it for massless particles with both ml and nr equals.
This is clear.
Okay? But this is of course not the only way to get massless particles. We could also try nw of 1 and 1. That will also sum these two. So we could try 1, 1, and then if 1, 1 works, minus 1, minus 1 also works. Okay? Then we said nl equals 0, but now nr is not equal to 0 because 1 minus 1 is 0. So we have to set nr to 1. Or we could try 1 minus 1 and then minus balance work. Nl equals 1 and nr equals. And then finally, there's 0, 0 with nl equals 1 in R. This is a comprehensive list of the ways in which you can get massless particles at the special value of the radius. Okay, it's now an interesting exercise to take these massless particles and to group them in, with symmetric properties under the Lorentz group of the non-compact directions. Okay, let's first count, you know, group together the scalars. Count how many scalars.
Okay, so plus everything the field theory would
the boys. That is D-menu, and 5 to the bench.
No! These people are interested. These gate goes up, these 6 gate goes from here are interested. You see, 2 of these gate goes came from here. Came from taking a mute text here and a 25 index here. These were familiar. These are the gate bosons that come from dimensionally reducing the graviton as the beam. But what about the other 4? Those came from here. Have no contribution from non-winding sectors. All of these have W with R equals 0. And so purely stringy objects. There's no field theory analog of these. There's no gravity. It's purely gravity analog of these objects. Okay? Now, I'm soon going to show you as we wait once we study the vertex operators corresponding to these guys in the little money cave. I'm simply going to show you that these 6 gate bosons group together into an SU2 times SU2 gate bosons. Yeah, these are not 6 U1 gate bosons. They're in fact gate bosons of a non-abelian gate. You can see this immediately actually. You see, all of these guys carry momentum and wind. And therefore are charged under the gauge boson that comes from dimensionally reducing the graviton and dimensionally reducing beam. Okay? So this is the theory of gauge bosons, such that gauge bosons are charged, carry charge under other gauge bosons. And only, the only consistent way to do that is in a non-abelian gate.
Exactly.
It's the W plus and W minus. A and W plus and W minus. And I will also show you that these 9 scalars transform in the fundamental bifundamental of this SU2 plus SU2. Okay, so these are also, these guys also carry charge under momentum and winding, these scalars. So they also charge under this SU2 plus SU2, and we'll examine in what way that happens. So now I've not shown you all of this, but we're already getting a glimpse of very interesting things. You see, what do we see? We see that you take string theory, which went non-compact, was relatively boring, in the sense that the fields had no non-abelian structure. Okay? There was a graviton. Listen.
So, these 9 scalars are in the fundamental bifundamental.
In the fundamental bifundamental. You see, you have to say how they're charged under each of the 2 SU2s. So, they'll be like this. 5 I2 fundamental of this SU2. It's not even fundamental,
there's
like 3 times. It's in the 3 times 3. Right. But these I and j are SO3 vectors. Size
The master spectrum is just that of U1 gates. You know, the U1 gate, the two U1 gauge bosons, and it came from something with no non-abelian structure, graviton. Okay, then you tune this circle size to a particular size, and suddenly you see the emergence of non-abelian symmetry. Okay, we'll see that. You might ask, how does it go away? How, when you move from this particular size to another small size, does it go away? So we'll say that basically will be like a Higgs mechanism. You know, the non-abelian symmetry will be broken to U1 times U1 by effective Higgs mechanism. We'll see all this as we go along. But it's a quite interesting. You get, there's a new source of non-abelian gauge symmetry. This new source involves winding strings in motion. Okay, there's more symmetry than you would have thought. The same situation, which is a very small amount of symmetry, maybe U1 times U1, in field theory, actually has a hidden S2 symmetry from the point of view of string theory, which has been Higgs domain when you move to large surfaces. Okay, we'll see this all in more detail. Just to give you the lay of the land before we do it.
So field theory actually breaks down at some point.
Well, there are new Oscar states. You know, the reason the field theory is a good approximation when every other state in the theory, every other string oscillating state, is well separated from it. That's no longer true. New Oscar states. Okay, it will be actually very similar to, you know, looking at an SU2 times SU2 theory with the matter in the 3 times 3. And then you slowly turn on a wave to that matter. Okay, at the origin, there's all the non-abelian structure. When you move far away, you just have the U1 times U1. Clearly, the effect of U1 times U1 theory breaks down as the wave of this thing goes to zero. Then the W goes on to mass become.
That case, you would see it restored at some high energy scale.
You would see it restored?
I mean, not some effective way. I mean, you fixed it.
Right.
This is not happening.
No, I think you would see it restored at some high energy scale here as well. You see, where is the. If you go to energies such that you can ignore the mass difference between these winding states. See, these winding states always exist. At every value of the radius. It's just that they're not massless at every. If you go to energy such that you can ignore the mass difference between these massive W bosons and the massless two ones, you will see the approximate SU2 symmetry once again. It will be the same kind of
thing. So this will be some partition which is, there's a temperature which is harmonically.
Which, yeah, if you have a generic value of the certain size, which will be a mass. That's okay. You have to go to energies in that order. Okay, very good. So, this was to show you how, in the presence of binding, you can get new interesting low-energy physics, new master states, and new phenomena. We're going to come back and discuss all of this in more detail. But in order to do that, it would be helpful to understand the vertex operators of this theory. So let's get to this. There's a partition function that I want to calculate. Sorry. Right at the beginning of this lecture, I should have calculated. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm going to take a 10-minute break before we go into vertex operators. This is just a little spectrum once again. Just to compute at an arbitrary value of the radius, the partition function, the one-loop partition function, this theory on the torus, just to show you how modular invariance is recovered. I'm sorry, this lecture has become a little haphazard. I have to go on a linear order. But it'll soon all come together. Okay, so we're rewinding to discuss the partition function of the string theory and an arbitrary value of the radius. Okay, so
get from the oscillators is unchanged. Okay? So suppose we we've got this X conformity theory, we want to compute its torus partition. So if you remember we had defined this beta function for you. So we want to define it. So there's a part that comes from the oscillators, including zero point energy. Which is totally unchanged in this level. Okay? So what are we doing? We're computing the torus partition function. We're computing the torus partition function of the part of the conformity theory that comes from this x. It's just this one concept. Okay? So we have this term that comes from the oscillator, and nothing has changed. So we get this, which, by the way, mathematicians like to write as eta of tau mod squared. And we can write it as eta of tau mod squared just because it saves us a lot of writing. Okay? So so the partition function is this business times what? Times whatever we get from the zero. Okay? So now let's discuss what we get from the zero. In the case of non-compact, theory, remember the way we did it. We said that, well, what we have is the spectrum of a particle on a circle of size tau 2. The spectrum of a particle on a circle of size tau 2, the particle has effective mass 1 over alpha. Okay? And then we said, well, then that is tau e to the power minus tau 2 times k squared plus n squared dk integral. Then we did the Gaussian integral and we got the answer that was proportional to 1 over square root tau 2. Okay? Now, we want to do the analog of this here, but there are two differences. Okay? What are the differences? The differences are, firstly, that firstly that we have winding, and secondly that momentum is discrete. Okay? So let's do it more carefully. So what we're going to do is compute trace of q to the power n0, q bar to the power n0 bar, from the zero mode sector, from zero, the zero mode contribution of that, when we have the circuit compact. Now, L0 is simply equal to 4 by alpha prime k L squared, the contribution of 0 modes, and L0 bar is 4 by alpha prime k R squared. So what we want to do is to compute trace of, and this trace now is just a sum over n, q to the power 4 by alpha prime k L squared, q bar to the power 4 by alpha prime k R squared. Where, remember, k L and k R go back to that form. This one may do what? Because alpha prime. Involving m, n, tau 1 and tau 2. Okay? The algebra is a little painful, but it can be done. I'm just going to quote the result. This thing is exponential of minus pi lambda into alpha prime n squared by r squared plus n squared r squared by alpha prime plus 2 pi I tau 1. This thing is equal to this thing. Of course, we still have to sum up right here. By the way, can somebody give me an interpretation of this tau 1 being multiplied by n times w? Does it remind you of something we said we saw beginning in this class? What does tau 1 couple do? We just plugged in tau 1 here. The operator multiplies L0 minus L0 bar. L0 minus L0 bar is in tau. So the integral over tau 1 in the integral over the moduli space of the virtue of the torus will infer us that L0 minus L0 bar of the oscillator L0 minus L0 bar is equal to L0. That's something we solved. There's a new contribution coming for bottom tau 1 compared to what we had just on the oscillator. Okay? The usual thing for the non-compact guy was that the integral over tau 1 enforced that L0 was equal to L0. Okay. So, this is a sensible thing, and then this is where it is. This is essentially like the energy of the state. Okay? Now, I'm sorry. Polchinski called W, in my notes I have A. I was looking at Polchinski and trying to translate W to M. Thank you. Okay. Now, you see, this expression here is multiplied by this 1 over eta tau, and written this way, it's far from obvious. It's far from obvious that this expression gives us a modular invariant one-loop partition function of the torus. There are two sources of non-obvious. But firstly, mod eta squared by itself is not modular. It needs an extra factor of square root of tau 2, exactly. Square root of tau 2 into mod eta squared is mod. Okay? So firstly we need a factor of that somehow, and then the sum has to be modulated as well, and it's far from clear that that's the case. However, you see, there is an interesting trick here, an interesting technical trick, that allows us to demonstrate modular invariants and has a physical interpretation. So let's first look at the technical trick, and then look at physical interpretation. So what I'm going to do is take the sum over n, that is the sum over all the momentum modes along this circle, and do it after and Poisson result. Okay? Let me remind you what that means. Okay. See. Suppose you've got some function, some f of x, which has Fourier decompositions, which is equal to f of k, f tilde of k, e to the power 2 pi I kx. Okay. Now, I want to claim that the following is true. That the sum, provided there's reasonable follow-up properties of these functions, that the sum of f and m
is equal to the sum of F tilde the 2 pi zeta. Okay, now this is something you're all familiar with, but let's quickly see. Oh, yeah, I leave it with you to check that this is true, or you know that this is true? Basically, what's the point? Suppose you take this thing, say, what do you want to do? You want to take this and sum it over all the values of A. So that's what you want to do is to calculate, that's the same thing as integral dk, f of k, and then sum over n e to the power 2 pi I k m. Okay? So you want to know what this thing is. Now this thing is a little ill-defined as it stands, but one way to understand it is to put, you know, to discretize space-time and compactify it. So you have to put the values of m to be periodic with periodicity in to discretize the possible values of x, yeah, and then allow k to take the allowed values, namely m divided by n, to respect the periodicity of the problem. Hey, my hypothesis is substantial. Let's just do it. Okay, so suppose we're given a problem in which we have periodicity of this function or as a function of x or with periodicity capital. Okay, then the allowed values of k, okay, then the allowed values of k would be k is equal to n divided by n. Okay? And of course, there would be, because we're only looking at things, you know, discrete points, there would be an effective periodicity in K. M goes to M plus N would be a periodicity in this function. Okay? So now this is a very well defined mathematical object. Okay, let's call it R. So suppose we do sum over it. This is e to the power 2 pi I. R m divided by n. M runs from 1 to n. This is very clear. Right? This object is 0, sum over the various roots of unity, the nth root of unity. So it's 0 unless R is either 0 or n or 2n. Okay? So this is equal to, and then it depends one of those values at n times. Delta R 0 plus delta R n plus 1. Okay? But now you want to undo this discretization to go back to continuum language. So this sum over n becomes like an integral over n. But we're interested in integral over k. And the difference between k and m is the factor of n. Okay? So if we want this to be true, we want to replace this by an integral, these get replaced by delta functions that get rid of the factor. Okay? The only tricky part in this whole process is getting that normalization, right? But this is correct. So once you define things this way, this is correct. Okay. Great. So now. We're now going to apply this formula. We're now going to apply this formula to that object, with x being taken to be the object n. Okay? So what we want to do is to compute integral into the power 2 pi I, and now we'll replace n by, let's say, r. So 2 pi I. No, that was not the best. Yeah, we want e to the power 2 pi I r x
then minus pi tau 2 alpha prime by power square x square. Plus 2 pi I tau 1 into xm. Right? There's also this part. But since that does not involve our variable n, which I call x, okay? It just goes along with that. So let's do this stuff. Let's do this integral. Firstly, you see this part and this part are very simple. So this is integral e to the power 2 pi I. And then there is r plus tau 1 times m times x. And then minus pi tau 2 alpha prime x squared pi. So what do we get? In doing this integral, we get the factor of square root pi that we get from a Gaussian integral. Then we get square root of this stuff. So we get square root pi, square root alpha prime r, and then a square root of that 2. And then we get what we get by completing the square. That is the exponential of, so completing the square, we remove this 2, we take this squared, pi squared, r plus tau 1 m the whole thing squared, and divide by whatever's here. So pi tau 2 alpha prime and r squared. Where's the half? This 2 has cancelled the fact that it's twice. If you complete a square,
so the standard deviation is the variance gets inverted. So it should be 2 sigma.
Ah, you want a 2 here.
So I think there should be a factor of 4. Gets inverted.
Very good. I hope that's not really going to be trouble. Wait a minute, all I've done is complete a square.
Okay.
And that's completed. So this thing. No, I think this is okay. You see, what I've done is
before you have defined. You have the 2 when you square them, right?
Yeah.
This is the 2.
Yeah. Okay? So this is r by square root alpha prime tau 2. No, so 1 by tau 2. This is the thing that we wanted to take the modulus there is beta. Times exponential. And now, so this pi cancels this. We have, and now we added what we had from here. And this minus sign, by the way, because the I square. So, minus pi minus pi into tau 2 m squared r squared by alpha prime plus r plus tau 1 m the whole thing squared, but that's an r squared as well, divided by alpha prime. That's all right. But this had an r squared, that had an r squared, so that's good. Yeah. And I put some tau 2 somewhere.
Again, it's a 1 over tau 2.
there was a tau 2 there, and here there was a time. Let me make this tau 2 squared divided by tau 2. Okay. And now, this numerator can be written as
that's good.